Holy sh! That's an S1000RR BMW. I guess some lucky dude who worked hard for it just ordered one, and yeah, probably getting home or probably getting back from service, I don't know. But what an amazing motorcycle, man. I've never gotten the chance to ride one of them. எங்க வரீங்கண்ணா? I'll definitely be needing to upgrade to a front disc setup. This is horrible. I would have simply crashed into him if my brake was just a little bit less powerful. Crazy and scary at the same time. I'll look into my options.
Hey guys, Bratty Baker here. Hope you're all doing well. So my motorcycle has received a substantial upgrade, and here it is. A front disc setup from the Pulsar 150, from the first generation Pulsar 150.
And in this video, I'll let you know guys, whatever that you need to do to get this installed on your Yamaha RX based motorcycle successfully.
When you're in the market for a front disc setup for your motorcycle, you have a lot of options available, but for my particular motorcycle, I have chosen the front disc setup of a first generation Pulsar 150, which we'd lovingly call the classic Pulsar with the round headlamp and stuff. There are a few reasons why I chose this Bajaj Pulsar's front disc setup for my motorcycle. Number one being affordability, because this setup is more on the affordable side of things when you're in the market for a front disc setup. Number two, almost all the parts that you need to get this installed on your motorcycle, regardless if it's a Yamaha RX series or a Suzuki AX series or even a Kawasaki KB series motorcycle, it's easily available even at your local two-wheeler spare parts shop. You'll not necessarily need to go to a Bajaj spare parts shop to get it. Most likely it will be available even at your local spare parts shop because of how common this setup is. And fourth thing, which is a boon, is this setup is almost a direct fit for a Yamaha RX series. I do not know about the Suzuki series or the Kawasaki series because I haven't experienced installing them, but for a Yamaha RX series, this setup is almost a direct fit. A major reason why I chose to use a first generation of the classic Pulsar's front disc setup is that you will not need to do any machining or lathe work on your lower T or your upper T that holds the inner tubes in position because of the distance between the left and the right fork or the tube and the thickness of this tube. It is exactly the same as the Yamaha RX, so you will not need to do any mods here or here, so you can directly just pop it inside. If you get a first generation DTSI one, then you will need to remove everything, get this T out, you will need to machine it a little bit bigger so that the fork will be accommodated properly, and there will be differences in a lot of parts like your wheel axle, the distance collar, and your speedo pinion, the speedo worm, so on. That is why I chose the first generation Pulsar's front disc setup, majorly. There are some minor alterations or modifications that are required, which I'll cover throughout this video. So keep watching, guys. Before you guys go over to get a front disc setup for your motorcycle, you guys will need to know what all you need to get to install this front disc setup for your motorcycle. So let me cover them now. I'll cover the kind of parts that you will need and the parts that you should not miss when you're getting a front disc setup for your motorcycle. Here are the parts that you will need. You'll need the disc plate itself, the adapter that attaches the disc plate to the wheel hub. You'll need the wheel hub. You'll need new spokes, and you'll probably need a new front rim, but if your previous front rim is in good shape, you can use it, but you cannot use the stock spokes, so get the spokes changed and check if your previous tire and your tube is in good shape, because if they are in good shape, you can reuse them, but otherwise you can change them. You'll need the distance collar or the wheel spacer,
you'll need a brand new front wheel bearing, you'll need the center axle, you'll need the caliper, you'll need the speedo worm, you'll need this new speedo cable, you'll need these four legs, both left and right, you'll need the inner tubes which hides beneath these rubber boots, you'll need this brake hose or brake line, do not call it the brake wire, you'll need this master cylinder, and you'll also need this brake lever. This is where you pour your brake fluid, some people call it brake oil. It is not an oil, it does not have lubricating properties, it is a hydraulic fluid designed to efficiently transfer this force here to the caliper to catch the moving or the running disc plate efficiently and powerfully. I hope I have covered enough for the first part. Now let's time travel back with the drum setup and go to the garage and get this disc setup installed on the motorcycle. So as you guys can see, disassembly has begun. They have to remove this entire set, the whole wheel, the hub, the fork legs, inner tubes, everything has to go out, and then we have to install the new pulses set. And here's the wheel is ready right there. You guys can look, looks good, just been spray painted for now, And since you cannot use the spokes that are present on your drum setup, and in my case I was not even able to use the rim that was present on my old drum setup, I switched to a Hero rim. Even my previous setup had a Hero rim, but unfortunately it was too bad. But my mechanic still said that Hero offers really good quality, so I just went with Hero rims. Yep, it's a Hero rim, and unfortunately you don't get good quality spokes. So for the spokes, I went for a brand called as Gold. This was the one that was available locally, and my mechanic says that this is the only one who are still making spokes for the first generation Pulsar locally, and he says that they are not of great quality, so you need to keep them clean all the time or they'll start to rust pretty quickly. So if you guys are able to get stainless steel ones or even good quality ones from say Gabriel or more reputed companies like that, definitely go for it guys, it's definitely of a peace of mind for you too. So yeah, that's there. Anyways, let us wait for them to dismantle them completely, and then we'll move on with the video. Installing is the Pulsar fork. As you guys can see, they just use the screwdriver to give a little bit of clearance, and then they have installed the front left fork. As you guys can see, installing the fork boot too. So you guys can see they've slightly made the space bigger between that top nut so that the fork goes in easily. And then now they've taken off the screwdriver so that the space is back to the normal position.
Yeah.
So the fork boots, the right one has gone in, left one is gonna get in. It's loosening it so that they can give this fork like a little bit more upwards, put a little bit more in. So yes. And regarding the mudguard, you can actually use the RX stock mudguard, but the problem is the bolt size here is a little different. This is 13mm sized holes for the mudguard fitment, while the RX fork legs has 10mm, so you will need to make the hole bigger on the RX stock mudguard. But what I did was, I couldn't use the mudguard because already it was damaged, it looked horrible, and when we tried to make the hole bigger it became an entire mess, so I could not use that mudguard. So this is from a Bajaj KB100, I think the company that makes it is called as I forgot the name, but you guys saw it on the screen right now. So you guys can check it locally or just ask for a 4S Champion or a Bajaj Boxers front mudguard. It's a direct fit on the first generation fork legs. And subscribers, you might have seen this video on doing this. This is from a Yamaha Entizer, and of course this also needed to be modded. And since this hole is also too small, I also needed to get this bigger. Let me guys try and show you here. It's actually a mess as you guys can see, but the fork legs cover it up, so not much of a problem here. But yeah, fitting this was a pain, and you'll see that now.
Starting with the number 3 clamp, which I installed. Gotta make the holes bigger. After a very long time of struggling, they are finally able to screw in this number 3 clamp onto this. And the whole pain is because it was not designed for such things, so it had to be modified. And mechanic says that once we fitted in the first trouble, it won't come again. We'll just you know, get into the shape. So another disassembly and reassembly would be a lot easier compared to this first time. But anyways, yes, looks good.
Before we can go ahead and install the front wheel to the motorcycle, we need to reduce the length or the height of the wheel spacer or the distance collar. Why? I'll let you know now. The set I bought, I did not receive this distance collar, and you guys have to get this distance collar. If you didn't receive it, you have to get this new. I'll show you the picture of the packet right now, so use that as the reference number. And you'll need to get this to the lathe and slightly machine it so that it will let the disc to sit properly in between disc pads, so the spacer helps in properly aligning the disc left or right until you find that perfect balance where the pads are not unnecessarily rubbing or scratching against these plates when you are not using the brakes. This is how the distance collar or the wheel spacer looks like. As you guys can see, we need to slightly machine it, reduce the length or the height of it. It sits on the right side of the fork, in between the right fork and the hub. You can skip this step if the provided speedometer worm is working fine, but if not, you can follow this step to buy a new one and modify it to match exactly as the old one. This is your speedo worm, and this is not what I got with the set. This is what I got with the set. This is a first generation speedo worm, and unfortunately it was completely jammed up, so it did not work, and this was not available anywhere. So what I had to do was I had to get this DDSI analog meter speedo pinion. And the problem is that although it looks the same here, it has another 8 mm of height, so you have to get it to a lathe and get it phased or machined. You have to remove this. So as you can see the small bare metal. Let me try to show you. Yeah, this bare metal where the paint is not there, because I've phased it so that it exactly matches with this old speedo worm or speedo pinion, and so it will not cause any clearance issue. You guys can see the process now.
The process is called as phasing, as you can see. We're using a vernier caliper to measure the size. It has to match that of the first generation Pulsar. That is why we're doing it.
New worms here is going to be installed onto the bike's left side, the hub's left side. Hope it works.
Okay, we got the worm gear ready. But to install and check if it is really working, we need the front wheel axle. I also did not receive the front wheel axle for the set. Usually you can use your stock RX axle, but it requires some modifications from the lathe, which I am unaware of. So what I did was I went to a spare shop and I got an axle of the first generation Pulsar set. But unfortunately, it is not original. It is from a company called as Mahesh Auto Center, MAC. I think it is easily available, so you guys can get that. It's working fine for me, no problems. Another option is you can look at the KB100's front wheel axle. It's a direct fit for these old first generation Pulsar setups. Will work without any mods. But finding one is the challenge. You won't find a new one anywhere.
Got the wheel in, we're putting back the axle inside, hoping that it would work. You guys can see it come out. Pat the brake. Brake it. Speed okay, but none. हाँ हाँ ओढ़ दे इट्स वर्किंग
नाला ओढ़ का पड़ रहा
आ पड़ रहा पड़ रहा हाँ ओढ़ देना इट्स वर्किंग सुपर ना सुपर ना सो गाइस दिस इज अ सक्सेस यू गाइस कैन सी द फेसिंग डिड वर्क प्रॉपर्ली सो या दैट्स गुड How they gonna fit the caliper back? Yeah.
Caliper.
Here you can see the mechanic is checking for clearance if everything is working fine, and I felt that it was unnecessarily rubbing, and my mechanic told that it is very normal for the first few days as the new pads will get set properly. So no problems there. It will be like that for a day or two. And then it will automatically get adjusted as it wears down.
So everything is set, guys. So they've put back the company's distance collar. It's working fine. I've used the brake lever from an Apache RTR because I did not receive brake lever in this set. You guys can use a Pulsar 220's brake lever. That's a direct fit. But I feel that this Apache RTR brake lever looks really good. And since this looks really good, I also changed my left side, this is called your yoke, and also changed the clutch lever to that, both to that of the Apache RTR. They look brilliant and they go really well, as you guys can see. They go really well together. And a small bonus is that we've used the Apache RTR brake levers there, and I thought, okay, maybe I'll just change the clutch lever too. So the yoke has to be changed and the lever also has to be changed to the Apache RTR. Looks really good. So yeah, it's working well. I'm happy to say that this ohm gear mod is working. So the speedometer is also working. Yep.
Now that we've cleaned the master cylinder, we'll be using brand new .4 brake fluid and we'll pump it so that it will reach the caliper. Pumping the brake fluid is the last job, and when the brake fluid has reached the caliper, your job is essentially done and the brake is now functional. So the mechanic will take it out for a spin now and then we'll be back home. For a test ride. So now that the entire front disc setup has been installed, I hope you guys got a good clear picture of what happened both at the lathe and what kind of job mechanic did to get this installed properly. So now I'll just ride the motorcycle and I'll let you know, guys, my first impressions, the advantages I can see, and one or two disadvantages which I might feel. So here we go for a ride.
The best part is you don't need to give so much pressure on the lever for it to brake hard. Like, see this. You can do this. This is definitely not possible with drums. Like, you need the pressure of all these four fingers. And constantly you'll be needing to do this if you're in a traffic. So this is a great thing. Like, you just need to keep your hand here when you're crawling through. So give accelerator, you give brake, give accelerator, you give brake. I think rather than the braking getting so much better, this is a fantastic thing, fantastic future when it comes to, you know, sitting riding these things. Brakes really, really well, incredibly well. And this is the Pulsar setup. This is one of the cheapest sets that you can install on your RX. This is only going to get better, you know, as you go up using a Gladiator or an Apache RTR or any other setups like that which are more expensive than the Pulsar setup. I think the Pulsar setup is adequate because it improves the braking so much. I don't think you really need any improvements from here. I really don't think that you need to, you know, spend anything more for getting a more expensive setup. I don't think you need that. But if you can, hey, who's stopping you, man? You can go for it. So as you guys can see, Apache RTR brake and clutch levers, and of course, yes, the yoke has been changed, and that's how it looks. And yeah, so the total, you know, package along with the Shogun handlebar, the Shogun mirrors, Apache RTR levers, everything looks really good, at least to my eyes it does. So yes, definite upgrade for you guys. And you know, if you guys are changing just the brake lever, I also suggest you to change to the Apache spec too, because otherwise your right brake lever is going to look too big and your left Yamaha lever is going to look a little small, so it's going to be a little disproportionate. So it's a great thing if you guys are going to change it, change both of them, change with the yoke, get the RTR lever, doesn't cost you much. The yoke I think it costs 200 while the lever costs 120 bucks I think. So yes, that's a difference. And one more thing, since this does not have any paint, it will not peel like other levers. This is just like machined buffed stuff, so there is no paint to peel off from here, so that's a good thing too. Does this guy want to go straight or left? Come on, man. So as you guys can also notice that almost every single bump is felt on the front because of this Pulsar setup. This Pulsar setup is designed for Pulsar, which is a much heavier motorcycle. So the problem is the suspension feels very stiff compared to the soft RX setup. See that? There is literally no damp rebound here. Every single bump is felt, man. That is one major disadvantage on this Pulsar setup. I'd still not say it is a disadvantage because it is just what it is. It has its advantages too. Having a stiff front end is good when you're going for highways. You want that stability. You don't want a very soft suspension at the highways. You don't want it to bounce all over the place. So yeah. See that? No indicators, but these disc brakes definitely help, because if not for that, if not for disc brakes, I would have, you know, almost rear-ended him, because yeah, I did not know that he was turning left. So in many such situations, many such scenarios, having a very good braking setup out front, you know, with the use of disc brake, of course, is very, very helpful, guys. It's lifesaver. It's a lifesaver, seriously. Yeah, definite upgrade. Definite upgrade for two-stroke guys like the ones you owning a Yamaha RX 100, 135, Shogun or a Shaolin. I do not think that the Samurai or the Max Standard R, they are not that powerful enough to require a front disc setup. So no harm in installing one either. But it's not really needed. Kind of power that the bike makes, I don't think a front disc setup is very much needed. The drum should suffice. Now that the disc has been installed, what next? What next is I'll be needing to change my clutch plates, pressure plates. I'll be needing to reset my clutch basket or the clutch bell. And then I'll be needing to change both my chain and chain sprockets because they are all worn out. Meanwhile, I'll also be changing the wheel rubbers and the rear wheel bearing. So that video will be coming really soon. Now that we're back home, that's it for this video, guys. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please do leave a like below. Please do comment your video suggestions and your video requests. I shall put in my best efforts to get it done for you guys. And please do subscribe to the channel for more two-stroke content. K
keep the blue smoke alive. Bratty Biker signing off. Have a wonderful day, guys.